Good. All right. We are here. Hi, everyone who has seen a couple of the interviews I've done. I'm Erin Zimmerman. I'm helping with the Latino Arts Festival this September. And today, oh my gosh, I'm so excited for our conversation. And I know that I said that on social media if you've been watching it all, but we're talking about Mucho, Mucho Amor. And I have with me Tamara Falicov. Did I say that right?
Yes, you did, Erin. Oh,
gosh, I've only known you for like a handful of years. I finally get it right. And she is going to be talking with us about Mucho, Mucho Amor. And so I wanted to go ahead and let you introduce yourself. And if you have whatever else comes after that happens.
Thank you so much, Erin, for inviting me. I'm thrilled to be part of the Latino Arts Festival. This is a time of year that's really important to me personally, as someone who has parents from Argentina who didn't grow up watching Walter Mercado, but I really enjoyed this film. And when we were discussing what kind of film to discuss, since I teach about Latin American cinema, this one was an obvious choice. And part of it is because it's a Netflix produced documentary, which is to say that there are more people that have access than ever before. I remember teaching my first course in Latin American cinema over 20 years ago, so it's been a while, and how some of these films are hard to access. Subtitling, just circulation of films in the film festival circuit or in the theaters tend to privilege, you know, big Hollywood blockbusters. So to have Netflix come on board to help bankroll an amazing documentary like Mucho, Mucho Amor, I can't wait to hear a lot of your voices in terms of what was resonating with you or questions you have if you've never heard of him before, but you stumbled upon the documentary. So I hope we are able to engage with an audience and talk about what made this man so enigmatic and so alluring to so many millions of people. Shall we start?
Yes, I'm super excited. Do you want to start with questions or do you want to watch the trailer?
You know what? For those who have just popped on who maybe haven't seen the film, the trailer will hopefully entice you to want to see the whole thing if you can get access to Netflix. So why don't we just roll it, Erin? That'd be great.
All right, perfect. And here is the trailer.
Okay, I'm ready.
El señor Walter Mercado.
Walter Mercado.
Walter Mercado.
Que ha salido para ti, Acuario, nada menos que la fortaleza, porque tú estás fuerte ahora, ¿eh?
We grew up with him. I can't think of an English language astrologer that would command the attention of millions of households.
Escorpio, te pones ahora insistente.
Some people who speak English do not understand how loved you are in the Spanish community.
He's very much his own incredible creation.
He's an androgyny. He looks like a woman. Sometimes he looks like a man.
He was like one of the biggest characters, yeah. Not just with Spanish TV, anywhere.
But all of a sudden, he disappeared.
Yo tengo la teoría que tal vez no quiso envejecer ante las cámaras.
¿Puedo decirle edad?
No. Since the moment I was born, I know that I was not like everybody. Everything about me was different.
He made you stop. He had the stop quality.
Phil made me the most well-known psychic of this world.
I can guarantee you Walter did not make millions of that. He didn't have someone really looking out for him.
Entonces, ahí es que empiezan los problemas.
You use a cape because you're a superhero. And I see Walter as a superhero.
I'm a fortune teller, but I don't like to know my future. I just want to enjoy this moment of my life.
El amor es la razón de todo. El amor es el alfa y el omega. El amor es la razón de vivir.
Y que reciban de mí siempre paz, mucha paz, pero sobre todo mucho, 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 ¿qué? Amor.
All right.
What a beautiful trailer. There's so much there. This is such a rich film.
That was definitely, like, when I saw that, I thought to myself, I don't think I know who this man is, and I need to see this. Like, that is what I thought. And then as I was watching it, I thought, I remember the commercials. I do. And then it brought me back.
Well, that's interesting because he gets famous first in the I think it would be the 80s when he's on the news every night and you hear the story of the abuelitas, the grandmothers who are telling the family, shh, 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 he's coming on. But then there's that piece about the 1990s when he's part of the Psychic Friends Network with Madame Cleo and all these other psychics. And I remember that too, Aaron, actually. And I didn't hit until I saw that clip. And another funny thing is I can't say his name in Portuguese, but you might remember that he becomes super famous in Brazil in the 90s. And his name is Call Me Now. That becomes his nickname. Like, chamame já is how you'd say it in Spanish. So he has these different modalities. He's on the news, which is actually very interesting because it's a very legitimized space. And it's a space where families are going to watch every night and hear the news in Spanish. It's for the Latin American, Latino, Latinx community. And so I just wanted to start. I am so happy we have this space for people to comment and ask questions. And so we welcome your questions, but I'll just start by talking about why it is maybe this film was even made and why perhaps this man had such a strong presence in these households. I mean, he's not your typical man, right? Let's talk about him. What drew you to him, Aaron, when you first saw this persona?
I immediately thought this man does not follow gender roles. And I'm super interested in that along with just the powerful presence. I love Prince, for example.
Okay.
And people who just live life outside of these weird boxes that we acknowledge, we know they're there and we keep living inside of them. And I say we just in general terms.
Yeah, of course.
Because I still feel like, you know, I grew up just in some of these boxes from society. And there are people who just naturally bust them wide open and don't have any qualms about it. And so
That's
I was like,
right.
This is someone that is very, you know, this is someone I need to watch this.
Yeah, I mean, he's very comfortable with his persona. He calls himself an artist. I think artists have always historically kind of pushed the boundaries of societal propriety, is that a word? The proper norms, you know, propriety. When people would tease him because, you know, listen, one culture that has a lot of issues with this question of the gender roles is Latin American culture. There's this term machismo, right? This machista culture where men have the superiority over women. And it's changing slowly, but it's pretty remarkable that a person like Walter Mercado was able to enter into this domain where in the documentary, you see him on talk shows with a lot of men who are clearly homophobic. Let's just say what it is. You know, they're uncomfortable with him. They don't want to kiss him or they tease him. And I thought that that was so important because you know that there were young people, you know, these kids who may have felt different with their grandmothers and grandfathers watching the show, and they're looking at him and they're saying, well, look at this guy. He can be himself. He can express himself. And not only that, but this man is expressing a love, un amor, peace. He's comfortable. He's not angry. And, you know, the other thing that somebody pointed out, and it was also in the documentary, is his predictions for people's future were always positive. It gave hope to people. And so for me, being a child of immigrant parents, I'm pretty sure that immigrant communities really could resonate with what he had to say, because they're in a new country and they need hope. They want, so he was their North Star. That was a wonderful quote that I read today. He was a guiding light for people who felt worried about, you know, the precarity of their everyday life, their job situation. They're vulnerable. They have to send money home. And he's saying, it's going to be okay. So he was a calming force.
I love that. Well, and it's not just calming. I mean, even in his voice, just the way that he carried himself and that he spoke, it was calming. It was kind of like poetry, I felt, just the way that he spoke. And, you know, even as I was watching, and sometimes I actually had to pause it a handful of times because I was watching it and I was like, this is so hokey. Like my brain would go in that direction at times. And then I would pause it and sit with that. It's like, why do I think it feels hokey? Like, is it because this is just outside of something that I would deem normal? And it's like, well, what's normal and why would you want to be normal? And then it was then that I started to like embrace, you know, there's magic in this, whether he was actually a magician of sorts or whether it's just like allowing that that kindness and the childlike expressiveness, words are not working right now, but like okay. Of love that we knew as children and then have since like derailed off of that. Like we need to unlearn some of these things that we have learned. It was the childlike sense of wonder and magic and love that really got to me. And then by the end, I was a huge fan.
Well, I appreciate you saying that because I think he had a lot of obstacles, not only in terms of his appearance and his demeanor that was kind of seen as outlandish. I think Liberace faced this too. These are larger than life characters. But on top of that, you know, he wasn't a singer. He wasn't a performer. So, you know, anybody else would maybe at least have the power of their voice, but he had astrology. So imagine being an astrologer and having this really incredible androgynous look with these huge capes. But what's funny is astrology, we think that it's somehow not scientific and occult and delegitimized, but I always remember Ronald Reagan, one of our presidents. Somehow it was okay for Ronald Reagan and Nancy to have their own astrologer, Sidney Omar. People all over the world have their different forms of spirituality. And so some have said that in the Latin American community, there is a very strong Catholic impulse. You know, there are a lot of religious people. But what Walter Mercado said was, look, for me, I take from multiple religions. I take from lots of different kinds of spirituality, and it doesn't matter what you call God. It's just this higher power that you believe in. And especially in Latin America, when even though you have Catholicism, you also have Afro-Caribbean religions, Afro-Brazilian religions like Santeria, Candombe. These are animist religions that are syncretized with Catholicism because when slaves came to Latin America, they had to hide their animist religions. And so they attached their religion, their orishas, these deities, to Catholic saints. So Yemaya is also Saint Barbara. So there are these incredibly syncretic religions already in Latin America. So for some people, what he was doing, it fit in. It fit in with their worldview. So that may be something that Anglo audiences, like you were saying, this is kind of hokey. Well, sure, if you are someone that grows up in this very kind of established, and not, I'm not saying you, and again, in general, yeah, this established religion that, you know, is organized and it's institutionalized. Well, in Latin America, there's more diversity, I think. And so it worked fine for him.
Well, and I love it. You know, I grew up Catholic. I like to say I'm a reforming Catholic because I like to take the good things about it. And then I'm, you know, trying to get rid, at least from my life, of the things that negatively impacted me growing up or are not so great, that come with religion, that come with many religions, not just Catholicism. And so, you know, getting into a little bit of astrology and some of this other spirituality and magic is, I think it's great because thinking of everything, especially in a world that feels like it's just like falling apart around us, I feel like it's necessary. I feel like we all need Walter Mercado now more than ever.
That's right. I mean, he has a message of tolerance and peace and hope. And I think right now he's coming back. You know, the filmmakers are 20, 30 something filmmakers. They are saying, we remember our grandmothers loving Walter Mercado. But if you saw the documentary where they had a 50 year anniversary of his performances at the Miami Museum of Art, there were many young people and many memes that have been generated, many millennials saying, this is the kind of icon that we can embrace. I thought that was so beautiful, like an owner of a bar creating a bathroom stall with Walter Mercado's face, drinks named after him, gay and lesbian folk, you know, saying, hey, we need to have diversity. We are so happy that he represents, you know, differences and broadening out the way the people that we see on the screen. So, you know, interestingly enough, this may be a throwback character, but I watched a critique of the documentary from very different perspectives. One was an El Salvadoran guy who was saying, he was talking about different parts of the film where, you know, this was definitely a way to honor his life. And he died only after watching 20 minutes of a rough cut. And then unfortunately he passed away. But this young man on YouTube was saying that, you know, he really got taken advantage of by his manager. And he was kind of ruminating on that and saying that, you know, Walter Mercado maybe had to not trust so much and that he was being naive. So I thought it was interesting how different people watching this documentary could find different stories that maybe could instruct the viewer. Because it is a sad story too. We're talking about like how he was this larger than life, incredible person that had millions of followings, but other people noted his home is not a $1 million mansion. You know, his life wasn't, he couldn't predict the future, right? Like that's the irony. It's like, he can tell everyone else's future, but not his. But he had this problem with his someone he trusted. And that was really sad. And then the second YouTube video I saw was these two drag queens, one in LA and one in New York, who I think became famous through RuPaul's show. And they were saying that he was very much like Richard Simmons. And I don't know, Erin, does that name ring a bell to you?
Yes, very much so.
Okay. And at first I was like, I don't know. Like, I think sometimes people keep trying to put people in boxes, like those pitch lines. It's the, you know, Jaws meets, you know, Fast and the Furious, right, or something like that. And I go, I don't know if this is really analogous. But one thing about Richard Simmons, if you remember his exercise show, is that he was very positive and very hopeful. You can do this. You can do this. And we need that kind of inspiration. We need that kind of confidence when we don't know what's going to happen next. These people that are grounded and they say, you know, it's okay. Believe in yourself.
Yeah. And on top of that, it's like, as much as you don't want to compare one thing to another, it kind of also helps bring that. It's like you had said before, Liberace. And I had seen, you know, some descriptions of Walter being, you know, a mix of Oprah and Liberace and all these other things. It's like all these, you know, yes, great people that we, you know, kind of idolize for their different reasons.
Yeah.
And I see it, and I see the Richard Simmons, because for so many reasons, but like that, again, going back to like that childlike, at least persona, not necessarily persona, I guess, but like in the way that they talk and not that they are simple, but they have simplified these ideas of love and of magic and of, you know, community, even community around working out or community around astrology. And they really simplified things so that everyone feels welcome around them. But at the same time, there may be a piece of naivety there that is beautiful until someone takes advantage of it, until you see the, you know, how the other side of that may look. And it's frustrating to watch. And I went through every emotion watching this. And I think that the filmmakers really did a really, really good job with it. I don't think it was just showing how he was taken advantage of, or, you know, a downfall or anything like that. I think it was very well-rounded, at least from my perspective. What were your thoughts on that?
Yeah. I mean, look, they took 3 years to get to know him. And one of the questions was, well, was he hard to reach because he was in this kind of isolation period after having this terrible business debacle? And one of the filmmakers said, actually, it was very easy for him to jump in. He's a performer. And the other filmmaker said, yeah, it was hard for us to film him because he was so easy to work with. He is constantly noticing the presence of the camera. And so if at the very end of the documentary, there's like a little cute blooper at the end where they call him like the one take wonder or something like that, which now I understand what they mean, which is that he can just immediately turn it on and off. So great subject to work with. I really like your point about the naivete, the childlikeness. He played kind of an innocent character, not, you know, being asexual for all intents and purposes. Like, I don't know if we need to spend a lot of time on that point, because that part kind of irritated me, that everyone wants to know his sexuality as if it's anyone's business, you know.
And on top of that, maybe it is vague. Maybe that's just what it is.
It's ambiguous. Again, it's that
box that we're trying to put people into. And it's like, no, people don't.
They're always like, you know, supposedly when you walk down a dark alley, the first thing you notice about a person, if you're passing somebody in the dark, is their gender. It's like people need to know, they want to put you in a box to know, like, okay, what are you exactly? What is your sexuality? What is your gender? And he was defying that. And in fact, you know, the caretaker, William, I think his name was saying like, he's androgynous. He's a man one day, he's a woman, and that's just who he is. And I think now people are saying more about like non-binary, gender fluid. So perhaps now he would have had an easier time. But I just felt like
he wanted to, like, maybe he just doesn't want to define it. Again, remember, people, this like gender started a California wildfire here, at least one. So really,
good choice.
Do we need it?
It's destructive. Yeah. We need more Walter Mercados. Mm-hmm. But it's just funny how obsessed people are about that. You know, there's that funny scene where he says, like, I have sex with the wind. I have sex with the universe. Like, it was beautiful.
Laughed, but also it's beautiful. It is. It's beautiful.
It's beautiful. He just had his own ideas. And I think in a way, it's amazing that he became mainstream. Like, I bet there are a lot of people like him that are kind of marginalized, you know, and yet he was somehow, I think because he was such a talented actor, he spent a lot of time talking about that in Ponce. When he goes back to Puerto Rico, he talks about his time on the stage. I think he just had a really good combination of many things. And by the way, he acted in telenovelas. And I think that's an important point, because you have to admit, with some of the clips of his program, it is over the top. You know, he's got like flames and, you know, statues, and it's just very decadent and not what we're used to seeing. And it, frankly, it fits nicely with this idea of melodrama, with kind of high drama. It's, you know, the definition of melodrama, it comes from melos and drama. Melos meaning music. So music would often be accompanied with the drama, and there's no such thing as a gray area in melodrama. There are the good people and the bad people, good and evil. And the filmmakers did a lovely job, because they had the tarot cards as a way to kind of frame the different sections. So you were asking what I thought about the story structure and the way that directors filmed him. I think they felt very comfortable with him. He's a loving person, and they definitely got close to their character, but they also showed that he could be very vain sometimes. You know, he would look at himself at the museum and say, wasn't I a handsome man? So he was very human. They made him human. I think, you know, there's this idea of a hagiography, which is, you know, to elevate someone to sainthood and only show the, you know, the flawless sides of them. But we're all human. He drew from the universal, but he was not a god. He was human. He said, I'm a force of nature. Yes, but you're human.
Yeah. And I feel like maybe sometimes that even may have gotten lost on him a bit, because it's like the persona that, and I could be wrong, I don't know, but that's just what I saw, because the persona that he put out in public, as you can see during the documentary, he is also that persona at home, but maybe he isn't when the cameras aren't around. Like, we don't know, because he seems to be turned on as himself pretty much the whole time. And even when he was very frail towards the end. And so, I mean, you could see parts where it broke a little bit, and you could see, a little bit of like you had said, humanity, he's human. But before this, everyone had seen the magician. And then when he was not the magician, obviously, but I'm just saying, like, on TV, yeah, that's what it seemed. Right, exactly. And then he disappeared when he could no longer be that full person. So it's either on or completely off. So I did, you know, just like we've been talking about gray areas and not fitting into a box, I kind of like that, that they're able to show that in, you know, his entire life. Not obviously they were only with him for 3 years, and you can only get so much when someone wants to be turned on in front of the cameras the entire time. But I feel like we got a good feel there, that we wouldn't have otherwise if they wouldn't have decided to do this.
Absolutely. I mean, the timing was right. They said that that the cosmos was on their side. They submitted their film to Sundance on November 1. They tried to do the best they could working with him. And then the next day he passed away. You know, so it's one of those things that make you think about, look, who are the elders in your community? Who are these people that you revered as a child? You better go work with them now. You better talk to them now, get their stories, because he's not with us anymore. And yes, he disappeared, which that was another interesting way they structured the film, because one of the people who viewed the film on YouTube was saying, so I want to give credit wherever I get information, because I didn't think of this. He turned on the film and was sort of narrating as he was watching, and he said, well, wait a minute, Walter Mercado just disappeared. Did he die? Did he not? Boy, this film is kind of leaving me hanging. And then you had a very famous Mexican actor, Eugenio Derbez, say, I think he purposefully dropped out because he was getting old and he's afraid of being old. He doesn't want to show his age. He's very vain, which it wasn't true, but that was a really interesting theory. So he was a man of mystery. And then when this happened, that he disappeared because he couldn't use his name anymore, he was forced to disappear. People created stories about him, and that's because he was so iconic and mysterious that they didn't know. So I found that really interesting.
I'm kind of curious what it, and you've seen it more recently than I have, but I'm kind of curious what it took. I know they said that he was easy to get a hold of, but like for him to say yes to showing some of these, you know, real human things about himself. Like, I'm just curious about what that may have been like. And I don't recall if they addressed that at all in the documentary.
Well, I will say that they did ask him a lot of questions and he did handle them fairly well. I mean, he made kind of funny jokes about it. So I think they told him, we want to be as honest and open as possible. It's a great point. I couldn't even believe they had the manager that they sued on the documentary. I mean,
right. I get those people.
How do you get people? When I teach documentary, you oftentimes do not get the other side of the story because that side does not want to participate. So your point is very well taken. They were quite successful in being able to get the el malo de la película, the bad guy of the movie, to be in the film. And you kind of wonder if it's him, but it's like, but no, he's talking so well about Walter.
Right.
So somehow they had an amicable breakup because he's in the film. So I found that really interesting. There was something else I was going to say about, okay, I don't know. I lost it, but let me think about this. So the filmmakers, they had a kind of a blooper reel that I got to see, which they were showing some things that they wanted to include in the documentary, but chose not to. So I'll share those to kind of add, kind of fill out the whole narrative, as it were. Yeah. One thing was, and I think maybe this was in the documentary, they asked him, Walter, if you could make an autobiographical film, if you could write one about yourself, who would you cast as the main character? And he said, oh, for sure, Timothy Chalamet. And they kind of were kind of giggling about that, like, okay, cool, he's a hot actor, you know. But they were pointing out that he was very much like this Fountain of Youth guy, like the picture of Dorian Gray. It's just an interesting, like, I don't know if he was a narcissist, maybe you could say that. But there was this really interesting psychological portrait about him that he did seem to be kind of self-absorbed. But I will say that later on in the documentary, the family, the I don't know. Are they sisters? Are they cousins? I can't remember. I think
there were nieces involved.
Okay. The three nieces that went with him everywhere. That mm-hmm. was really beautiful because I felt like, you know, it is sad when there's someone that's so famous and then once they drop off the map, they're forgotten, you know? So in a way, these filmmakers are recuperating a history of this man who did disappear by all intents and purposes. However, he had his family. He had his nieces that were always by his side. So I love that. The other thing I wanted to mention is, you know, he lives in Puerto Rico now. What I understand is that Lin-Manuel Miranda was going to San Juan to promote Hamilton. They were going to perform it. And he wasn't taking any press. But when he heard that there was a documentary being made, and this was the first scene that they filmed for this documentary about Walter Mercado. Mm-hmm. And so Lin-Manuel said he would do it because of, you know, how he felt growing up and seeing him, that this was the linchpin for how the film was made, was able to be made and financed. So once again, talking about generations, Lin-Manuel Miranda was key. Because he threw his support behind the project and felt so strongly that this was somebody that was worth documenting and discussing and elegizing, they were able to find the funding. So I think that's very important that you need those kind of veteran angels to support your projects. Because look, Aaron and I know each other through women in film. We have been involved in the filmmaking community, and these are really good tips for people who want to make movies, but they're so expensive to make.
Yeah. Yeah.
And also Karim Tash, one of the co-directors, I'll just say their names, Karim Tash and Tabsh, sorry, I'm going to say
I'm
it
not
wrong.
Going to be any better.
Okay. And Christina Constantini, they were saying that they had been pitching this project to Hollywood studios for a very long time and were being rejected right and left. So Latinx stories are still struggling to be made, even in this era of Black Lives Matter and trying to elevate different groups, it's still a big uphill battle. And so someone like Lin-Manuel is, you know, supportive and representing a community that it's hard to break through, but he, golly gee, he has. And so he wants to put his support behind other projects like this one.
Yeah, well, and I love that too, bringing up, you know, the power in people outside of Hollywood to help, not necessarily dictate, but kind of what happens. Like wherever you put your money is where they will start heading. There's a conversation that I got to be a part of at South by Southwest in 2017. And there were a handful of people that were part of it that were both in front of and behind the camera in Hollywood. But they were talking about how much representation matters, but it's not just like who's on the screen. It's kind of like a chicken and egg thing. It's like whatever you put your money towards, whatever you pay attention to, whatever you show up at the movie theater or, you know, purchase on Netflix or whatever it is right now on Netflix, on Disney, however it works, whatever you're watching is what they will start putting money towards and start paying attention to. And so I think that's really powerful that it's like, well, if you have the means and you have the passion or the interest in something that to support it in whatever way that you can in order to see more. So if you want to see more Latinx people on screen, then that's where, like, if you're going to the movies, those are the types of movies you go to see people that aren't just white people like me in front of and behind the screen. And, you know, that's one of the things that I have been very passionate about for a long time is getting more female representation, but not just that anymore. It's all genders because, you know, you don't just want, I don't just want to see white men represented as protagonists. I don't want to see white women as protagonists necessarily either, but like better than just white men or just white men writers, white men directors, you know. And yes, there are great ones and there are great people of all races and backgrounds and genders that need to be seen and heard. And so I like their approach here in and using this resource, really, Lin-Manuel as a resource, where they probably were like, hey, this is an added bonus if he can put some money or his voice behind this, but to just get him in it as a not only as someone who's really excited to get some excitement behind it and get that fun meetup inside of the film, but also to, you know, just lend his voice to, hey, we need more people in front of the screen. We need more Walter Mercados, or we need, you know,
definitely
more diversity for sure.
Well, and so to add to your point about audiences and paying with your pocketbook and kind of showing like there is money in these fields. In fact, you know, Latino families actually spend more money at the movies than other families, white families, any other families. Why? Because, you know, this is a stereotype, but Catholic Latino families can be large, and it is the least expensive, wonderful family outing activity. One of the least expensive. It is still expensive. Let's like, we all know that.
Yeah.
But that is one reason why you can't even use the economic argument with why there aren't more Latinx films, because they're part of the audience. So my attitude is, who's behind the camera? You know, like Ava DuVernay is very clear on this. They have done studies. If you are a woman of color behind the camera, you have like an 87% chance more than a white man of hiring a diverse cast. Like, there's definitely this whole network actor theory of making films where you tend to pull people on your crew and in front of the camera that you know and feel comfortable with. So the more we can diversify people behind the camera, the more we're going to see these kinds of stories. So for example, Kareem Tabsh, he owns the biggest art house theater in Miami with other partners, and he worked on the Gay and Lesbian Film Festival in Miami. So this is a man who has been super involved in his community in Miami. He has developed this story working with, you know, Walter Mercado. He teamed up with another filmmaker. These are young people. That's useful because, you know, let's face it, there's a demographic, what is it, 18 to 34. And Walter Mercado he's an older man, right, in the film, but it doesn't matter because they're there and they value him. They're recuperating him. So I think that that's important to note as well.
And another piece that you just reminded me of is that, yes, these are younger filmmakers, you know, bringing some fresh perspective potentially to some, I don't want to say something old, but, you know, someone who has been around for, you know, his persona has been around for a very long time. He has spanned generations. However, we were getting to the point probably where there are people who are like, who is that? Not just white people.
Well, no, you know, and a lot of white people don't know, but these people, the young folks can really expand an audience that maybe would never have turned on. Like, you know, one of the YouTube people who didn't know who he was is like, oh yeah, I kind of skimmed through that channel and didn't know who he was. Well, no, look, it's the filmmakers, but it's also Netflix. I'm going to go back to that. I started with that. I'm going to go back. For all intents and purposes, Netflix has some problems, okay? Go down to Colombia and you talk to producers about the issues that, you know, Netflix brings when they come to film. So I don't want to give them a pass.
Right.
But I will say they have been a little more risk-taking. They produced Roma, Alfonso Cuarón's film, this one. I'm sure there are other Netflix films that have more diverse topics. The Five Bloods, I think, is on Netflix. Sometimes I get confused with Amazon Studio, which is also doing that. Kevin right. Wilmot's films is why,
yes.
You know, Spike Lee's films. So that that helps with access. That brings in a new audience.
Yeah. And I love that they chose someone who is older, because that's another thing. In addition to having more people of all races and genders in front of the camera, it's telling stories of folks of all ages. And it's frustrating whenever people feel like they're aging out. And it's probably one of the reasons that Walter Mercado was like, you know, when he had to leave, it's like, okay. And also not wanting people to see his age potentially, or that, you know, he's not ageless, you know?
That's a very good point, Aaron. And I had not thought of that, but you're reminding me of a very funny video made by Julia Louis-Dreyfus and one of the Arquette actors. I can't remember which one, who it's like, and Tina Fey, and this is a bad word, so I'm going to say something like, you're not effable anymore. Do you know about this video? It's about women who are actors who turn, I don't know, 40 years old, like they're not even old, and they age out. And so they made these really funny jokes about like, well, yeah, I got cast for Santa Claus's wife, you know? And so they're making this point about how Hollywood can be very cruel. It can be cruel to people getting older, especially women, okay? But nonetheless, Walter Mercado, yeah, there is something there in terms of waning popularity. I'm also thinking Sunset Boulevard, the famous film where she's this aging diva and says, you know, will you please get this profile? I don't remember the terms, but that's another form of exclusion. So I appreciate you pointing that out.
Yeah, I'm just happy that they did this. I'm very glad they did this. It introduced me to someone, you know, decades after I should have been introduced. You know, it's one of those clicking through daytime TV kind of things. But it helped me really to, again, like I said before, like I'm a fan of Prince. I'm a fan of some of these people who live almost otherworldly to me. And in my head, I'm like, I don't understand why that can't be my existence too. Not that I have to be exactly like them, but that I look at them as like, as an idol or as someone that like, I could never do the things that you've done in your lifetime when really you can. And it humanized him in a way that I could be like, okay, I can make decisions for myself to be fully me. And I hope that's what it did for other people as well. Maybe they watched him growing up and they had these thoughts of, oh, he's super strange. He's super out there. But no, he's just being fully him. And I hope that we have more people in front of and behind the camera who are fully being themselves that can show us that, especially people who, again, are not just white men. And I will harp on this all the time.
That's okay. And hey, we actually, we're going to wrap up. We have only a few more minutes, but look, we have somebody who posted. So that makes my day. Cause yes. I mean, I love talking with Aaron, but it's nice to know there's somebody watching. So Elizabeth Snyder, kudos to you.
Yes. Thank you.
She states, I love the movie and learning about Walter Mercado. Everyone has a story and his was very compelling. And I think his ultimate message was love yourself, be an authentic person and love others. And remember that those are the basic human values that really matter in this world. And whatever I can do to give you hope and inspiration, like telling your astrological zodiac forecast, we'll do that for you because that's going to be your North Star. That's going to help you feel that at night the stars are shining upon you and you're going to be okay in this country. You have a community. And that's so, so valuable. And I'm just glad that these filmmakers were able to tell his story before he was gone.
Yes. Me too. And I am so, thank you for taking the time today to talk about this with me. I watched it obviously after the pandemic started, because that's when it came out and I didn't really talk with anyone about it in person and I needed to. I didn't know until today how much I needed that. So I appreciate you and coming up with this idea, because just so everyone knows, Tamara is like, oh my gosh, she is so smart and I don't want to say so educated, but like you have a very, very robust library of things you could talk about that you know a lot about. And to come back to Walter Mercado and talk about it in like taking all of these other pieces of your, you know, education and background and everything and being able to apply it to this is just, I just love it. And every time I talk with you, even if it's just a very, very short catch up, which it seems like is all that we've been able to do in the last handful of years, I just feel so invigorated when we talk about all of this stuff, well, about anything.
Well, likewise, Erin, it's people like you who volunteer to really make culture visible. And I appreciate you and Diana who organized this festival so that we can actually highlight and elevate people like Walter Mercado. And we can have a space to talk about these very important figures in people's lives that don't get mainstream press except when two very ingenious filmmakers work out a deal with Netflix and we can see a bit of this culture. Mm-hmm. This is all around us. There's so many beautiful stories that Latinx filmmakers are telling, and we just need more venues like this to be able to talk about them.
Yes,
so thank you for listening.
Well,
and thank you, Erin.
Yes, and thank you for your time, and thank you for everyone who has tuned in for the live and for the replay. And hopefully, maybe soon we can, you know, talk about a couple of other things, because there are a lot of options to watch Latinx filmmakers and actors on all of the streaming platforms. So I hope that people are taking advantage of that, not just this month, but going forward.
Love it.
Take
care.
Thank you so much. I'll talk to everyone later.
Okay. Bye.